Let's take a break. You've been going nonstop for a while now.
No. I don't want to stop on that. I need to keep going. At least a little more.
All right, if you're sure. So what happened after Candy died?
I don't really remember. I'm pretty sure I was in shock after seeing... after that. It's kind of funny, actually. I'd seen so many people die already. I even saw Joy get murdered right in front of me. But something about Candy's last moments. How they spent it telling me I deserved better. It broke something in me. I don't know how long I stayed in that cave crying, but Jill eventually had to carry me out.
Hey guys, quick update on the Kickstarter campaign. Jill O'Lantern the Final Cut has been funded, but don't let that stop you from going down to the description and checking out their page, because there's still some time to help the development team hit their stretch goals, which include a new minigame feature and an entire extra chapter of the game set at Cravenport University that could include some extra romance gameplay. So if any of that seems like a cool idea to you, go check out their Kickstarter page in the description below.
She sent me down at the entrance and said she was going to go clean up and went back inside. When I couldn't cry anymore, I stood up and just started walking. I don't know if it was fate or just muscle memory, but eventually I ended up back at the docks. Everything else had come full circle, so I sat down at the edge and waited for Jill to find me again. Sure enough, she showed up a few seconds later.
There you are. Well, I got the spellbook, and you're alive. I guess that finishes up our contract. Look, I know it didn't end how you wanted, but... sorry, that came out wrong. Look, humans die, right? It happens all the time, you know? Joe? One minute they're alive, the next they're not. That's just how your world works. Jill, you're not helping. Look, about what happened tonight, I'm not gonna lie. Things got really, really fucked up. Like, I have no idea how I'm gonna write a report on this. You are concerned about yourself? This is just... this shouldn't have happened. That's it. This just should not have happened. But it did. So now I'm gonna break the time loop spell and take this thing back home. Did you hear me? Job's over. I'm leaving.
Fine.
Wait, what?
I said fine. Just go.
Wait, you're not gonna try to talk me out of it?
No.
Oh! You're just setting me up so you can pull some fancy logic trick, right?
Not this time. Just go.
But the whole point was to fix this. Stop everyone from dying, remember? Why are you giving up? We can still go back and try again.
Why? So I can watch them all die a third time?
Kind of.
Huh?
It's fate or something, right? I never had a chance at saving them. It's always gonna be just me at the end. Vivian Fenella, the final girl at the end of the horror movie. That's what you've been telling me, right? We're just stuck in a cheap slasher fic and we can't change the ending.
Vivian, look, Thrice, damn it. You're supposed to be talking me into this, not the other way around. Look, I can't leave things like this, okay? The way Candy died, Fuck, this is going to haunt me forever.
I think Jill just wants a piece of candy.
They were a fucking badass. A non-binary, polyamorous badass.
Yeah, she wants a piece of candy.
They didn't deserve to go out like that.
And why does that matter, Jill? You were gonna kill them and everyone else on this fucking lake just a few hours ago, remember?
I didn't know.
You didn't want to. You didn't care. You just wanted to put a couple notches into your machete.
But I didn't kill anyone.
You came here to slaughter every person on this lake and take back your book. So congratulations, Jill. Mission accomplished. You win. Now go.
Back home, I'm a bit of a screw-up. I always try my best, but my professor says I never think things through. I'm always finding shortcuts and cutting corners. I always think it'll be fine, but then someone else has to clean up my mess. When I got this mission, I thought it was finally something I couldn't mess up. Nothing to overthink, just go in, do the contract, get the magic item, and have fun killing a few nameless extras while I was at it. Simple. But I think I finally get what my professor's been trying to tell me. There aren't any extras here. Every human has their own story, their own life. Hell, humans probably have more of a life than we do. I mean, all we do is watch. I wanted it to be a game. But you humans, you're not characters, you're people. And there's nothing simple about ending a person's story. Unless they end someone else's.
Well, I'm glad you get to have your little character growth moment. Too bad it's too little too late.
We've got to do something. We can't just leave this with Candy as some stereotypical sacrifice to teach my dumbass a lesson. They were way too good for that. And they saved your ass too, so you owe them.
I know, I just don't know why. They kept saying they know me, but I can't remember them at all. And I can't help anyone because of my stupid broken brain.
Your brain's not broken, V.
Yes, it is! I'm a...
You're what?
Plot?
I'm autistic.
That's what? It? That's all?
And?
It means I can't think the way other people do.
Honestly, sometimes that's a good thing.
I know what it means, and duh.
Huh?
I knew from the start, V, you handle crazy shit way better than most humans would. Probably because most normal things seem weird to you anyway. So you process stuff differently than most humans. So does every demon who's ever lived, including me and my professor. Being autistic or neurodivergent or whatever you want to call it is nothing to be ashamed of.
It is when it's all anyone ever sees. When I was diagnosed as a kid, my parents acted like I'd been declared brain dead. They made sure to tell everyone I met that I was autistic and not to expect anything from me.
Parents are dicks.
Fucked up. Mm-hmm.
So was that one girl. I was
either too loud for them. They were always trying to teach me how to fit in with normal kids, while also telling them that I was fragile and stupid. What made it worse was that they were right. Stuff other kids could do easily, like spelling or memorizing the multiplication tables, just felt impossible. I did my best, but nothing ever seemed to click. I was put in special education programs, but they didn't even try to educate me. They wouldn't even let me learn with the other kids. They just give me half the answers on every test to make sure I passed. They just wanted to get me through the system. I didn't have to go to normal classes. And the special ed teachers didn't do anything with me so long as I was quiet, so I spent a lot of time reading a book. So long as I was quiet, I was free to read whatever I wanted. So I read whatever caught my interest. Probably read a couple things I shouldn't have, honestly.
Sounds like you got an education despite them failing to help you.
Not a real one. I still don't know my multiplication tables or half the stuff most people my age seem to know. I never interacted with anyone, so I never got better at learning social cues or how I was supposed to act. If someone asked me about my day, I'd tell them about how I learned that human bodies can be crushed into diving helmets just 60 meters down. Then they'd look at me like I was threatening to crush their heads, even though they were adults and I was 12.
That's still a cool thing for a 12-year-old to know.
No, it's just creepy.
Agree to disagree.
What else did you read about?
I really liked mysteries, especially Sherlock Holmes. I kind of idolized him a lot. I wanted to be able to figure out a person from the dirt on their clothes, or what dog they had from their walking stick.
Yeah, if they chewed up the walking stick or something.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it seemed a lot easier to read evidence than social cues. That's how I got into forensics, and then forensic psychology. Though it's not really the same. I don't know what to say when someone asks me how my day is, but I can make an educated guess on someone's life based on what their bedroom looks like. I'm not perfect at it, but it's easier. At least, that's what I told myself. The truth is, I'm not smart or clever. I'm not a savant. I'm just doing the best I can. The best I can do is put us right back where we fucking started.
So, if you can't think normally... So what if you can't think normally? Nothing about this night has been normal by anyone's standards. But we can figure this out. We know a lot more than we did last time.
Doesn't matter how many times we do it. We'll all just die again in some new horrible way.
You can't think like that.
I can't fight fate, Jill. I don't know how.
V, it's not fate.
Everyone who died the first time is dead again. Everyone! Even if we stop them from being impaled or being melted, they'll just find some other way to be killed. I would actually like to contest that.
Yeah.
Kenny's not dead.
True. Yeah, Kenny's trapped in a barrier between realities. Which is kind of like a state of death and undeath at the same time.
Uh-huh.
Schrodinger's Kenny.
How did South Park never do that?
I don't want to see that anymore. I'm tired, and I'm already going to have enough nightmares, and I think I'm still technically dying.
Wait a minute. Wait just one damn minute. Not everyone is dead.
Give it time. They will be.
No, they won't, because they can't die. At least, not until spell ends.
It is about Kenny! What are you talking about?
The dude who lived to get the hot dogs! Ha-ha!
Kenny?
You said he died in the cave last time, but he's in the spell's buffer, remember? He's untouchable in there, completely safe.
So we get everyone in a van and throw them into the buffer.
Everyone into the buffer! We don't even know if he made it to the buffer. He could have crashed his car before he made it there.
He didn't last time, but okay, I'll humor you.
What are you doing?
Checking the spell's expulsion cue. We're a bit far from the border, but I can at least see if there's anything ready to be.
Jill?
V, I never thought I'd get to say this, but... We saved Kenny!
Seriously?
Serious as I can be. There's a human and a car inside the buffer, ready to be spat out into your proper reality, safe and sound.
We can actually save people?
1,000,000%. Doesn't matter if reality wants you dead if you exist outside of it.
How many people can fit in the buffer?
For a spell this size? A couple thousand. Okay, we're good.
Thousands? There weren't even 100 people at the party.
Well, everyone in there can have some leg room.
We can do this. We can save everyone. We just need to get them all to go home.
Then, we pick up the spellbook from the cave, now that we know where to find it, charbroil the witch so that she can't kill any more demons, and save two worlds and our favorite non-binary badass in one swoop.
And then we all go home for a three-way.
And then maybe get some answers about who they are and why they care about me so much. Is she our fairy godmother?
Maybe.
And maybe ask them out on a date.
And maybe ask them out on a... Jill!
Oh, come on. They are so obviously into you.
Let's just focus on saving everyone, okay?
What's to worry about? We got this in the bag now. First, I show up at the party and scare everyone into the barrier. Next, we head back to the cave, and I'll show you why I'm called a pyrodemon. Then, we pull the book out of the ashes, kick back on the beach, and take a well-deserved break before heading back to reality and all the annoying paperwork waiting for us.
I can see why your professor says you cut corners.
Alright, what did I miss?
Scaring people will cause problems. The witch knows everything, the witch and Joy, about burning the witch.
Mark has a gun.
Yes.
There's another problem I don't think you know about yet. The witch knows you're working with me, and she remembers everything that happens in the loops. Just like us.
What? How?
I don't know. She just said, "You don't think I'd lose memories to my own spell, did you?"
That's a good impression.
But that turned out to be bullshit because she can't even cast the time loop spell.
Well, hold on. What do you mean she can't cast the time loop spell? It's part of the book. If she can't do one spell, if she can do one spell, she can do them
she
all.
She can't read old German. Apparently not. She wanted me to tell her how I did it. She called me a magical prodigy.
What if Joy
something?
Was the one who summoned Jill?
Interesting. But that doesn't explain how she knows about us.
She said she had a crying spell or something. She was using it to watch us the entire loop.
Scrying?
A scrying spell? Thrice damn it. That's annoying. Fortunately, that's one spell I know exactly how to deal with. She won't be able to see us coming next time.
Can you keep her from looking at anyone?
No. Scry blocking is kind of like a camouflage umbrella. She won't be able to detect where we are or see us, but it's centered around me. Which means we'll need to find each other pronto next loop.
But she'll still be able to see Joy. And Candy!
You think she might try to take hostages?
She already did with Mark when she caught us in the cave.
So we're gonna have to be careful not to give her any targets we actually care about.
Scaring people will cause problems?
Scaring everyone probably isn't the best way to get them to leave.
Why not? I scared Barbecue Boy into running. In fact, I might just torch his ass anyway for what he did to Candy. That'll give the rest of them a reason to run.
I mean, we can lose Mark. If we're gonna lose anyone.
Yeah.
True.
Yeah.
That won't make the best first impression with Candy. They won't remember Mark killed them, remember?
What if they do?
I don't think you want the only human you like thinking you're a murderer.
I mean, I am, but good point.
Also, if you do whatever it is you did to Mark and start a panic, people are going to run for their cars and all drive off at once into a forest. And those roads aren't very wide.
Oh.
Yeah. Oh. I already saw a couple cars wrapped around trees last time. Not to mention cowards like Mark would be more than willing to run over a few people just to run away faster. People like Candy who would be focused on getting other people to safety.
The rice, damn it, okay. So we need to make everyone leave calmly.
But the reason needs to be urgent enough that they have to leave. That's not gonna be an easy balance.
Get rid of the booze.
About burning the witch, she can't see her. Oh, I don't know if it makes a difference, but the witch is actually Joy's aunt.
Holy subplots, rat man. Wait, didn't she kill Pumpkin Heater in the cave?
Yeah, just like she killed Joy's mother, her sister, who was the original owner of the book. Joy comes from a whole line of witches.
Great. So are we dealing with... So are we going to have to fight Pumpkin Heater for the book, too?
I don't know. It kind of seemed like she just wanted revenge, no matter the cost.
Well, she's in for a disappointment. First thing we're gonna do after I get you is head back to that cave and light that fucker up.
Yeah, she's not going to be happy with me.
Are you backing out?
Not on your life. And more importantly, not on Candy's.
Good girl.
Anyways, about burning the witch, you can't hurt anyone who has the book, remember?
Even if the flames can't touch her directly, that much raw heat in a confined space should do the job.
That's a fair assumption.
Yeah. Won't be a pretty way to go, but it's what she deserves.
And you're sure that won't violate your contract?
I just have to not look at or hear her. If I pour enough hellfire into that cave, it ought to drown out any screaming.
Fair.
That is, if she has time to open her mouth before it melts off.
That cave goes back pretty deep. Are you sure you can flood the whole thing with fire?
Remember when I blew my top earlier? That was just an embarrassed blush. I may not be the most elegant spellweaver, but I can spit fire with the rest of them. Although, since we're in the physical world, I'll probably need you close by so I can borrow some energy to do it safely. Don't want to burn myself out, literally.
I'll be right behind you. That witch has caused nothing but pain for everybody. It's not like we can put her on trial for any of this.
Trial by fire, maybe.
That's for looking at things with your eyes!
V, look out!
Jill, wait! I think, yeah, he's going the other way.
Phew, that was a close call. I can't believe that guy's still going.
Seriously, how is the chainsaw not run out of? Fuck! We forgot about the seventh sin!
Shit, you're right. Won't matter if we get everyone in the barrier if they're already going psycho. How do they even get infected with that stuff anyway? Do they smoke it, snort it, inject it? What?
Nobody knows. All the toxicology reports could determine was that it was likely absorbed through the digestive tract.
Okay, so you gotta get there early, dump all the booze and all the drinks into the lake so that no one can have them, and then everyone will leave.
It was the Coke.
The Coke or the water.
Mm-hmm. The water was sealed.
The Coke wasn't?
Who knows?
They had to be poured in the cups.
Oh.
Maybe they laced
the cups.
They were
poured into the cups.
They laced the cups.
So it was in something they either ate or drank?
Yeah, but that's where it gets tricky. Every victim had pretty much the same dosage. If it was in food or drinks, you would expect there to be a wide variation, depending on how much they had.
So that means it has to come in a pill, right? That's all the same dosage.
Hey, look at you with the deductions.
I have my moments.
Well, pills are the most popular theory, but how do you get everyone at a house party, some of you don't even drink alcohol, to all take one unidentifiable pill.
Pez dispenser? Or a breath mint?
Not a bad theory, actually. That means someone would have had to be actively passing it out. And there are pads like candy all over the party on the beach. Someone would have noticed.
Well, we know Candy wasn't affected or infected before they left, before you left the first time. That gives us like an hour to get everyone to calmly leave.
That's just when we know Candy started showing symptoms. Sevenson is very unpredictable. We have no idea when they or anyone else was actually drugged. Plus, getting everyone to leave is easier said than done. I tried last time, but nobody would listen.
What if you just tell everyone that the party's been spiked with Seven Sin?
How would I prove it without knowing who's responsible or how they're distributing it? Without proof, Joy and Mark would just say I'm causing a scene and shut me down again. I could warn Candy and the other Pads, but I don't know if they'd be able to convince everyone else until it was too late. I'd have to stay at the party without you.
And without you, I can't barbecue the witch. Thrice damn it. Okay, so in summary, you need to find a way to get all the college students to leave the lake and go into the buffer zone. And you need to do it before they all somehow become drugged with Sevenson and without me scaring anyone. Then, once you accomplish that little miracle, we need to kill the witch and get the book back. A witch who cannot go within sight or hearing of Anne for some reason retains all her memories from each loop.
And she saw everything that happened last loop, meaning she knows about my relationship with Joy and probably our relationship with Candy. Meaning she could take one of them hostage if we don't take care of her first.
So we gotta do all that while running defense. Yeesh. It never rains, but it pours. Thrice damn it, why didn't I actually put more effort into my glamour classes? Those could really help turn things around.
Wait, say that again.
My glamours? It's a branch of magic that focuses on illusions and...
No, before that.
It never rains, but it pours?
Can you summon
it? We're gonna make it rain! That's it! That's our answer!
It is?
What's the one thing guaranteed to ruin every outdoor party?
Ants?
Rain!
Oh, right. Cold and wet is bad for humans. Got it.
If we can start a storm early enough, it'll force everyone to pack up and go back to town to find another party.
And they'll run straight into the buffer zone without crashing into anything. Hopefully.
I just hope they don't all pop back into reality on top of each other.
It'll be fine. Most decent buffer zones are good about not materializing matter on top of other matter.
And the spell has a decent buffer zone, right?
Positive thoughts, V. Positive thoughts.
Fine, so how fast can you make a storm?
Oh, you want me to do it?
Oh, come on, Jill. Summoning a storm is like the go-to flex for every magic user in history. Even I've done it!
But I'm a pyro wielder! Yeah, but well, that kind of magic isn't exactly my strong suit.
Then what exactly is your strong suit, Jill?
Fire, pay attention!
Well, I'm pretty good at matter crafting. I mean, just look at this body.
Yeah, look at that body.
I work out.
Could you make, like, an army of yourself then?
Well, it's not exactly something I can do on the fly. Also, I am strictly forbidden forever attempting to create any kind of simulated intelligence for as long as I live. No AI for me, I guess.
Let me guess. More shortcuts.
But it's a long story. Oh, but I've got short-range teleportation thing down.
Only when people aren't looking at you.
My professor said it was... a very inventive approach.
Oh, what else do you have?
Let's see. Well, I'm a pyro demon, so fire, obviously. Just need to be careful with it, because I only have so much of my own power here. Although, I might be able to consume burnable fuel to replenish it. Maybe. The physical world and my world run on different rules.
What about those vines you keep summoning to grab my ankles?
Oh, those are just part of this construct. I sprout them out of the bottom of my head and push them through the ground. I'm actually using them as a skeleton for this body right now. Oh, that's cool.
Wait, so you're actually a tentacle monster, puppeting a buffed up scarecrow?
Oh my god.
Are we still having this three-way?
This is your fantasy.
Like I said, I'm good at finding workarounds. Don't judge me.
Well, try to find one for this.
Hey, you don't see me constantly criticizing your shortcomings.
I'm not criticizing you, I'm just...
Heartbeat.
Look, I'm sorry, I just need your help. I'm out of my element here. Ooh.
You and me both. I hate trying to memorize things, so I'm kind of useless without my notes or something to reference.
What about the spellbook? Could you use that as a reference?
It's worth a look. Let's see.
I think I saw a spell for summoning a storm somewhere in here. There it is!
Yeah. Yeah, this just might work!
So, you can cast this?
No, but you can.
Me?
Maintaining a spell like this and the scry blocking would drain me dry fast. But I should be able to tether this storm summoning spell to the time loop you already have going. That way, it will trigger the next time we loop automatically.
Wait, isn't that mixing magics? The very dangerous thing we should never ever do?
It's a great plan. I love this plan. I've always been on board with this plan.
It wouldn't be messing with the spell itself. I'll just be adding to it. Like tying a piece of string to an alarm clock so it sets off the coffee maker.
The mental image of you Rube Goldberging reality does not fill me with confidence, Jill.
Positive thoughts, V!
PMA.
Although, this is a pretty big spell. Running this and the time loop is going to put a lot of continuous strain on your body.
How much strain?
Maybe like double or triple what you're feeling now. Plus, there's going to be a big pull at the start to get the storm brewing. There's a chance you might pass out. And I'll need to draw some power from you to take care of the witch. Maybe we should find another way.
Do we have any safer alternatives that would offer us even half as much a chance?
No.
Then positive thoughts, Jill.
Okay, let's do this.
Good. Now, hand me that book. I need to check something. We made a plan for Jill to pick me up outside the party as soon as I could slip away, and for her to take care of a few things on our way over. Things finally felt like they were turning around, but we had no idea what was waiting for us in the next loop. So much was about to happen. I'd finally find out the truth about Candy, but also the truth about Joy.
Oh, I need to know. I need to know.
I need to know!
I'd figure out how the Seven Sin was being distributed and who was behind it. But of course, we didn't know that the whole time we were planning, our greatest enemy was there listening to us the entire time.
Us? The audience?
Chainsaw Guy?
Sounds exciting.
Look!
Sounds exciting, but we'll finish up after we take a break.
Remember, Patreon, end of this week.
Patreon? No, Kickstarter.
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 I don't know. They might have a Patreon as well. But like, yeah, for the most part, yes, it is still on Kickstarter.
Save.
And we need, yes.
Save.
Get dat. Yes. So yes. Link in the description below. Check out the Kickstarter for this. Check out this game itself. It's been really fun and engaging so far. And we really love to see how it ends. So if you can contribute a little bit, a little bit goes a long way. And we'd like to see the end of this. And we're hoping that you'd like to see the end of this too. So yeah, let's help make that happen. So again, in the description, check it out. We'll see you guys next time. Bye-bye, everybody.
Bye. Bye. Oh, I may not be the most elegant spell weaver, but I can spit fire with the rest of them.
Hey, thanks for watching, and if you haven't already, be sure to subscribe and ring the bell icon for notifications. If you enjoyed this video, give us a like, and feel free to check out some of our other gaming videos, our weekly podcast, Anime Yay or Nay, or our parody series, Madoka Magically Abridged. See you next time!